Good morning, everyone. If we can just find our seats, we'll get started. My name is Kunal Rambhia. I'm a senior analyst at the Center for Biosecurity, and I'm very pleased to moderate this panel today on drug and vaccine development. In the previous panel, we heard a lot about the roles of surveillance and sequencing in epidemic response. And in this panel, we'd like to talk about another aspect of scientific response to epidemics, which is the development of vaccines and medicines. The challenges in this field have been well documented, and cost estimates for successful development of a product range from $800 million to over $1 billion over 10 years. On the other hand, many of you personally are responsible for the successes in this field of bringing new medicines to market. But beyond the obvious, there are some additional important facts that I'd like to share before we introduce our speakers that are relevant to today's discussion. The first is that in its 12-5-year plan, the Chinese government emphasized investments in science and technologies to develop the Chinese economy, and they aim to spend over $300 billion, create 1 million jobs, and extend life expectancy by 1 year by the year 2015. And within that $300 billion, a significant percentage is attributed specifically to the development of new medicines. Just 2 weeks ago, the White House released a blueprint to strengthen the U.S. bioeconomy. One of the grand challenges in this blueprint is the development of the universal vaccine for influenza. Other goals include investments in research and development, workforce development, as well as reducing regulatory barriers. In 2011, China became the world's top patent filer, with the U.S. as the second highest. The U.S. and China have the largest generics markets in the world and have the first and third largest pharmaceutical sales markets overall. By some industry estimates, the Chinese pharmaceutical market is expected to grow at a pace of 20% annually for the next 5 years. So both from an investment and a market perspective, China and the U.S. are leaders in the development of vaccines and medicines. And with that in mind, I'd like to introduce our esteemed panelists. We're lucky to be joined today by two gentlemen who have studied in the United States and China, have experience in private pharmaceutical development in the U.S., and now have operations in China, which is to say that they're very well suited to lead us in the discussion today. First, we'll hear from Dr. Frank Liu. Dr. Liu is a professor and deputy director at the Chinese Academy of Sciences at the Key Laboratory in Pathogenic Microbiology. The Chinese Academy of Sciences is one of the largest scientific organizations in the world. If not the largest, it has nearly a staff of 100,000 in 12 cities across China. Dr. Liu has published extensively, including in Science and in PNAS, and prior to assuming his current position, he worked in the U.S. at Genzyme and at HHMI in Oklahoma. Following Dr. Liu's comments, we'll hear from Dr. Dong Ji. Dr. Ji is the founder and CEO of Frontier BioSciences and the Chengdu Frontier BioSciences. Frontier BioSciences operates locally here in Germantown, Maryland, as well as in Chengdu, China, the capital of the Sichuan province. His company is one of the leading contract research organizations in non-clinical toxicology and pharmacological services. Dr. Ji also has prior experience working at Fort Detrick in Maryland and at Tiba Tech, an infectious disease pharmaceutical company, which he worked at prior to founding his current organization. So with that, we'll start with you, Dr. Liu.
Yeah, thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you gives us this opportunity to come here to share some, our research, the thinking about the infection disease. Today, I just gave you this title, and it's called Changing Environment, Environmental and Emerging and Re-emerging Infection Disease, and how can we, from that point, to think about the drug development here. I borrowed the slides from my colleagues. The world, we are living challenges to the human beings. The global warming certainly is a big issue, and I'm not going to talk too much. There's certainly the global warming is a hot spot, and I think we are working on the infection and infection disease also is another hot spot. And so I'm just not to talk too much, and Well, I'm thinking, what the reaction, we should have. We're facing a lot of problems, especially recent years, we have SARS, we have influenza, we have, you know, E. coli, you know, the poison, you know, food poison stuff, and we need to do something. And as a scientist, what can we do? So we need to do the discovering. You know, we need to find out the pathogen. We need understanding what are the kind of pathogen we have. And then we have to identify the pathogen and truly understanding the biology about potential pathogens. And then we need to think about the fight, you know, the fighting back. We need to develop the drug and to probably the control or just prevention. And then the dancing with the infecting disease are coexistent for the long period of time. You know, we have some experience doing that. So also we need to know the global travel, you know, is you know, globalization also gave us a lot of opportunities economically and politically, and also we have a lot of communications. Certainly, you know, the pathogen also follow us, also globalizations. You know, that's another story that from the SARS, you know. You know, someone sniffed in Hong Kong made the ambulance in Toronto running around the cities. You know, this SARS, you know, is outbreak is a typical case for globalization. Also, you know, in the beginning slides, I mentioned about global warming and the new infecting disease. You know, there are some connections, but we don't know exactly. That's why we need to do more study. How the global warming really infect? How the global warming really linked with emerging or re-emerging infecting disease? For example, you know, the SARS, dengue, malaria, and the TB and the influenza. That's all the kind of disease certainly is challenge all the health. So from that slide, we can see the influenza viruses. You know, my background is working on the influenza viruses, and from that slide, you can see recent years there are more outbreak. You know, so different subtype influenza viruses outbreak. You know, certainly, you know, it's more give us more the challenge. You know, H1N1 in 2009. And cause globally, you know, the panic, certainly. So finally, we are released. Not like, you know, H1N1 in 1918, you know. So, but still the influenza still the cause of the bigger problem. You know, 250,000 people dies, you know, because the influenza. Probably this number is more conservative. Maybe we can see the higher numbers, you know, caused by influenza viruses. Regarding why, you know, recent years have more outbreak of influenza viruses, certainly this virus, this pathogen is different from the, you know, other HIV, you know, TB, because it's a virus, it's more diversity, and also, you know, from the evolution point, they're easy to have a new strains come out. You know, from this slide, just give you the, you know, how the interaction between the virus and the host, and this interaction really lead the, you know, the evolution. And for example, certainly environment played a role, you know, because host range is broad. And also, you know, this virus can be the infect people and the more stable. That's why it causes more interaction and then have more evolution change. And this slide give you another example about some factors also really contribute for the infection disease. And I'm not talking about more. Certainly, it's a big problem. And then we can go back the life cycle or nature cycle of the influenza viruses. Certainly, you know, the bird is a big reservoir, and you know, domestic birds means poultry, and they certainly is a host, and the pig is a, you know, intermediate host, and the human being certainly is a final host for us, and that means for the influenza viruses. And from that point, is this disease is not easy to control. Even it's not easy to make the good vaccine to really prevent. In 2005, and we published the paper and in Science, we first identified the migratory bird is a carrier for H5N1, you know, because I'm not seeing this really linked to the environmental change. Certainly, globally, you know, we draw this slides, we can see that, you know, beginning 2004, the first outbreak in Thailand, and then we identify in Qinghai Lake in 2005, and then, you know, probably follow the bird migratory route to the Mongolia, you know, to the European part of Russia, and then go to Africa. This we really think migratory bird play an important role for that outbreak. So, you know, we know this pathogen. We know probably, you know, how this disease transmission, but we still think about it. What can we do? Can fight back to develop a potential vaccine or drug. First thing, we have to think about the population level, and then, you know, individual cell and molecular level. As a scientist, we need to think about this. From the population level, we know the influenza viruses is a multiple host range, you know, viruses, you know, the infection. So, for example, poultry, even the pig play a very important role. We need understanding the evolution of these viruses, how these viruses, you know, recombinant from the new strains. And then I have to go, go to individual, you know, because the, each the, you know, different animal, they have a different response to the infecting disease. And then to have to go to the cellular level, molecular level, to really understanding, you know, the mechanism, how this virus really infected, how the virus really replicate. So, and the final point is, you know, we need to how the new pathogen emerging, you know, we understand that. And from that point, we have to dealing with host, you know, all human being or animals, and we have to deal with the environment. And then we can understand more about this possible, the, you know, the transmission. So, after that, we need to have more plans, think about do the vaccine development, and, you know, vaccination certainly is another good way to do that, and also we have to try to find out some inhibitors or even the antiviral drugs, and also we have to take care about eco-health, you know, the biosecurity, eco-health, and is another important issue for disease control, for for infection controls. Chinese Academy of Science, you know, is the largest institution in China. CAS has 100 institutes, more than 100 institutions around the countries, and we have three institutes also working on the infectious disease. First is the Institute of Microbiology. You know, it's I come from the Institute of Microbiology, and the second institute is from Shanghai, is the Institute of Pasteur Shanghai. You know, it's a couple years ago after SARS, our French government, you know, support has another location in China to work on the infectious disease. Also, we have another institute in Wuhan, in the central part, you know, central part of China. And it's also dealing with precedent, you know, infection design, you know, the study. From the CAS point, you know, I'm just give you an introduction of what we are thinking about infection disease. So we need to do something. And in all what called the key laboratories, we are working on the, you know, the we are working on the several issues. First issue, we are doing some vaccine development. Also, we are thinking about those adjuvants. You know, what kind of adjuvant can really improve the vaccine quality, can really improve the, you know, vaccine, you know, the efficacy. So this is one part we are working, and also we are working the microRNA. You know, it's another new type, you know, the new another new strategy probably can really can inhibit a virus. For example, you know, a lot of people working on the microRNA in the HIV, in the HPV, in the influenza viruses. All my laboratory also concentrated on working on the microRNA in the influenza viruses. So, you know, it's another potential approach to treat or to prevent the infection disease. So also we are doing some chemical drug development, even the inhibitor, you know, the drug development. So all, you know, we are, so far we concentrated three the major pathogen, you know, where we have in China. The rabies is still is big issues in China. HPV certainly, you know, we have a very high percentage. We call it the carrier or positive, you know, we are. So certainly also the influenza viruses. So this is what we are doing in CAS. Also, you know, the here just mentioned, you know, the, you know, what drug we are doing. So we are doing try to find out small molecule compounds, and my laboratory and the Georgia Gao laboratory. You know, now he's a deputy director for Chinese CDC, and his lab still in the IM. So we are working together, and this. So this is some, you know, research we are doing. This is his lab working on the structural biology, try to using the structural biology, you know, design some small molecule drug, and potentially, you know, can be used in clinical trial. So also in the HPV, you know, we are working on some, you know, the you know, adjuvant, you know, that, you know, we're using the GP96. And it's an adjuvant can stimulate, you know, the innate immunity, and it can improve the vaccine, you know, vaccine effect. So also we identified another, you know, the microRNA. You know, this could be the potentially for treatment of the HPV, you know, the infection. So. I'm just also the, you know, the IPS, you know, the Institute of Pasteur of Shanghai. They are doing a lot of research work on the infection disease. There are some people working on the vaccine development on the HIV, and also they are doing some potentially antibody, you know, the antibody therapy for HIV. And also they're working on the EV71, you know the EV71 also in China is another big problem for children. And also the working on the influenza virus. This is for the IPS. And currently they're doing some vaccine development, H1N1, they're using the VLP technology or DNA, you know, technology, try to generate new type of the vaccine. So the IPS they're doing. There's some the publication I'm not mentioning here. And generally, you know, we are thinking from scientific from the, you know, the lab research point, we need to think about how can we really develop the new type of vaccine. We know that a lot of vaccine already in China, and there's some vaccine are doing pretty good. There's some vaccine that have a lot of things that have a problem. Also, we think about the new concept. You know, the epitope, you know, the based vaccine could be another potentially, you know, in the future. So, you know, the peptide vaccine, for example, in the U.S., you know, HPV vaccine is kind of, you know, peptide vaccine. They're working pretty good in clinically. Also, the another technology we are doing the, you know, the viral-like particle, potentially that's going to be the good carrier for the, you know, the new vaccine development. And then we are also think about the you know, the new adjuvant. You know, we think about the adjuvant probably is another potential technology to really improve or maybe just, or guide the new vaccine, development. So this basically this, the way I think about it, what we are doing. So, we hopefully in the future we have more, potential products, linked with industry, and because in CAS, we are not only, do the publication. The more important part we have to do, try to work with industry, try to give industry some technical support, and then and try to give them, the more concept, regarding the research and the development. So this basically, regarding the what we are doing now. So also, I just give this, I give this slide to try to show in China there's certainly there's some successful vaccine in China, like Sinovac, biotech company there developed some several products and also kind of influenza virus is, influenza vaccine so far is doing pretty good. Also, for example, H1N1, and this also they have hepatitis A vaccine doing very well, and except that and how we have this joint adventure in located in the Liaoning province, they call the Liaoning Chengda biotech company. This they have the vaccine, the kind of rabies vaccine. This vaccine from the viral from the viral cells, and this vaccine marketing now is very well. It's the China is. So a lot of people have pet animals. Basically, we can how much how many pets in China. So I think we have a lot. Only in Beijing probably can have we count around maybe 3 million dogs, maybe more than that. So I think the rabies vaccine has become more more common. Up to the dog or cat, the bite people, they have the first thing they have to do, they have to do the immunization to make sure that later on they're not gonna get trouble. So also there are another institution and another company, the National Vaccine and the Serum Institute, they have a lot of a traditional vaccine also. So certainly there are a lot of potential, in the market, the vaccine is, I think they're demanding very, very high. So we hope, so we can have more support for the future, the vaccine development, even the drug development. And my institute also, tried, we have some facility to support this kind of research. I think Tom and Anita and Jennifer also visit our institute, right? So see all the new biosafety level 3, the laboratory. So this laboratory where we got certified, and we are going to work on the HIV, work on the influenza viruses. Probably we are working on another, the new emerging, potentially new emerging infection disease in the future. So this basically I just give you some briefly what we are thinking, what we are doing, and what we should do for infection disease. So thank you very much. Thank you for giving this opportunity.
Thanks, Dr. Liu. I think we'll go to Dr. Ji and then we'll take some questions.
First, I'd like to thank the organizers for inviting us to attend this very interesting conference. So this is new to us, and I'm very interested, actually, and it's a really pleasure to be here. We are from the private industry, so today I'd like to share our experiences in two new drug development programs. These were conducted both in the U.S. and China. And so, the share will be our view from our private industry. And in both cases, actually, private and public partnership plays a different but very important role. And through our personal experience, I will share with you what I see, the driving factor, what drives these mutual collaboration. and also what the potential challenges and opportunities out there. As you know, Kunal said, the business model for developing a new biological products just need to have a fundamental change. It's just simply becoming too expensive for even the richest country in the world, the United States. So from the last, actually 9 years, we've been trying to explore a different kind of model. And today, actually, I'm glad to have this opportunity to share with you. The first case I'm going to talk about is a product called Alburotide. It's the first long-acting HIV fusion inhibitor. This program was started actually very quietly about 9 years ago. I set up a small biotech company in Chongqing, China. And we know HIV/AIDS, you know, has been a global threat to almost every country in the world. And one of the current major efforts is to expand treatment coverage so that to control the epidemic. But one inevitable outcome of this expanded coverage will be drug resistance. And one of the main reasons of emergence of drug resistance will be the poor patient compliance. So with this as a potential problem, the program started by trying to develop a long-acting new drug that should be active against all current drug-resistant viruses. So that's what the Alburotide about. And right now we got proof of concept data in HIV patients that shows clear safety data, and also once a week administration that can show potent antiviral activity. So just to, instead of showing the data, I'd like to share with you our experience actually in, you know, what happened to the program during the last 9 years. The program has been fortunately actually received support from both the U.S. and Chinese governments. In the early days, all the preclinical efficacy studies were done in the U.S. and funded by NIAID of NIH. And we see actually the in vitro antiviral activity were tested at Southern Research Institute here in Frederick. And the in vivo efficacy study was done at University of San Francisco, of California, San Francisco. And also a very significant portion of work were done in China as well. You see the chemistry and manufacture were done in Chongqing, China, which is in the southwest part of China. And the non-clinical GLP toxicology and safety evaluation were done in Chengdu. And multiple clinical trials were just recently completed in Beijing. So this is really a true collaboration between U.S. and Chinese scientists. And right now, the program is going to move into a pivotal trial in China later this year, and also a phase one trial in the U.S. will be starting next year. And through this quite long collaboration, we see a lot of interactions and true collaboration between both U.S. and China scientists. And one obvious question also one wants to ask is the data quality. And the data has been generated in both countries. How would that be acceptable, you know, to the regulatory agencies in two countries? So actually from day one when we started the program, we put in actual efforts to make sure the data quality, as long as, you know, from the design to all the quality control components, are acceptable globally. And I will elaborate this a little bit more, especially to show you by selection of CROs involved in that, that has a track record in, that shows a track record for international filings. The program, again, even if it started in China, it has a global IP rights. And so far, we received a very convincing safety and proof of concept antiviral data in HIV patients. And now if you look at the number, it takes about 8 years to get this proof of concept data, and we estimate it takes about another 18 months before the final NDA can be filed. But if you look at the cost, so far it costs about $14 million. I have developed HIV drug in the U.S. Since 95, and I estimate this is about 25% of what it will cost to develop a drug here to get the same amount of data. So there is a tremendous saving there, although the amount of time is about the same. The next example I'm going to talk about actually is a technology by a U.S. company to develop medical countermeasure for acute radiation syndrome. That's probably not very much related to this conference, but it is from our experience also there's a very urgent need in the field. And we see potential dirty bomb and also accidents with a nuclear power station is a global threat, not only for developed countries, but also for developing countries like China and India. One particular observation we see in China is that China is rapidly building nuclear power stations, but mostly they are built in highly industrialized and highly populated areas. If you look at, for example, for Qinshan nuclear power station, there is about 500,000 people live within 20 kilometers of the nuclear plant. And for Tianwen, it's even worse, it's 1.1 million. So there is an urgent need, but right now there's no approved and effective prophylaxis or treatment agents for such a potential disaster. So starting from that, to get a first-in-class drug approved, there's a very critical resources necessary. First is innovation and technology. And fortunately, U.S. has invested a lot in this area, and there are quite a few very exciting new product candidates that's being developed. However, to get regulatory approval, these drugs need to be to receive the approval by the FDA, so-called animal rule. One of the critical components is instead of using a human trial, we need to develop an animal model that can simulate the response of radiation injury in animals instead of human to replace a human efficacy trial. But also, this is very challenging because we need to establish animal welfare programs to meet the international standards. And also through working in this field, we find, just like a clinical trial, individual difference between the animals can tremendously or sometimes even exponentially increase the required number of test subjects. So if you can have a very homogeneous or very high quality colony of test animals, that can tremendously reduce the scientific variables in the potential clinical trial. So all of these are new actually in the field and needs a lot of resources for developing a product. So there actually comes to the CRO, actually that's what I'm representing. What I'm trying to show here actually is, this is a CRO we started about 5 years ago. And I just want to give you an idea what's really a China-based CRO look like. And Frontier Biosciences has a test facility in Chengdu, China, which is a capital city of Sichuan. Although it's in the middle of the country, as you know, probably every city in China has a pretty big population. Chengdu in particular has 12 million people there. And more than 10 flights between Chengdu and Shanghai, is about 2 hours. So it's very close. And we have also operations in the United States as well. So what kind of people are involved in this program? You see, actually, even as a Chinese CRO, we have really Western-trained scientists. They have multiple years of working experience in the U.S., especially with major U.S. CROs. Both Li Tian and Mark work with Covance for more than 20 years, and also the QA director has a lot of years of experience in the U.S. So, the key are the people here play such an important role, we find, in the successful delivery of the drug development program. And the facility, in setting up the operation, is said to be complied with the international guidance, including the U.S. FDA, the EU OECD, and the Japanese MHLW guidance. And animal welfare always, one of the top priority in doing this kind of research. And the institute from the day one actually set a very high standards, and now it's we receive the OLA, NIH OLA assurance, and also the ALAC international accreditation. After setting up for 5 years, we have a couple of drugs tested in China, and now the drug has entered. There are numerous drugs entered clinical trials in the U.S. and also other countries. So, from the point of view of a U.S. company, why would it select the Chinese CRO? Because there's got to be something unique about it, because it's such a long distance to travel. So, from talking to the customer and also working together with them, we find what's important there is, first is people. You have to have experienced staff over there. And this includes not only those three people I showed you that have Western-trained experience, but also we have a whole group of very talented young Chinese scientists work with these senior scientists. And even sometimes, a few very skilled technicians are crucial to deliver some details of the program and in completing the study successfully. And another important thing is the past experience from conducting more than 25 this kind of acute radiation studies, and also accumulation of more than 1,000 animal database. This is probably one of the largest databases in this field as well. And also a GLP setting to assure the qualities. And proximity to radiation source to simulate potential radiation accidents. And also, as I said earlier, local supply of high quality and large number of test animals also is very important for this program. So just a summary. As the first program here, the product was developed by a private company, and there were private fundings in there, but there are significant grants from both governments. Chinese Ministry of Science and Technology funded part of the radiation source, and also the radiation facility received a grant from the Department of Energy to increase the security of the facility. And also UHDHHS has funded most part of the drug development. And in China, we see this program has completed the GLP toxicology and also the pivotal efficacy studies. And the cost of savings here is more than 50%. And not only cost saving, as I said, but also the availability of the simple scale that make it a very unique opportunity to work together with a U.S. company. And in the U.S., now the drug has completed phase one clinical trials. So again, you see, this is different from the previous story I told you. Previously, the HIV drugs, the innovation started in China, but now the work was done in both countries. And this is the other way around. So from talking about these two, just two cases, because it's such a big topic, I just very briefly summarize my experience in this field. Potential challenges of working from two countries together. One is IP protection. I think this has been covered a lot by the media. But actually, if you look at it, the situation of IP protection in China, especially in the field I'm in the biopharmaceutical field, has improved very rapidly in the last few years. Actually, this is supported by, if you look at the booming of the Chinese CRO industry, IP protection on confidentiality actually is a default and has to be respected. Communication also could be a potential issue, and we actually invested a lot into facilitating effective communications between the scientists and also on both the management side and also regulatory side. And it can be, language can be a barrier, and especially for our young technicians, they work in China, they don't understand English much. But after a while, actually, you can see the situation improve very rapidly. And time difference, we have 12 hours difference, And so that means, you know, probably very long working hours, especially for people like me. So that's difficult. Finally, I'd just like to discuss a little bit about regulatory difference, because for developing any new product, we have to have regulatory pathway, and the quality and the compliance has to meet the regulatory agency. One critical part is the clinical trials. So I just discuss very quickly what's the GCP practice in China. It has a very short history. We see it's a little bit more than 10 years only. In China, to conduct a clinical trial, it has to be done in the SFDA certified laboratories. So it's not like here that it can be done in anywhere. There are also some subtle, some regulatory difference. For example, safety reports. Here in the U.S., if you have a SAE, you're required to report, excuse me, in 7 to 15 days. But in China, you are required to report in 24 days. So, and also it's required both the sponsor and the investigator report. So that's one difference. And in China, the whole GCP system is still improving. And for example, right now there is no guidelines for biostatistics, data management, and also no requirement for central lab, for example, for EKG, pathology, imaging, and those. And I know people are drafting those, and but you know, China SFDA, as some of you might know, they are very short of staff. If you know, the Center of Drug Reevaluation has full-time employee of only 120 people. And this is just amazing compared with about 1,200 people in the U.S. It's just simply not enough for reviewing, and also to do high-quality review of this increasing number of innovative products in China. So there are a lot of discussions how to improve that situation. China also now very actively participating in global trials. In the area of infectious disease, we know there, China is a major contributing country for HBV, HPV, influenza drug-resistant TB, and first-in-man new antibiotics. This is the data from clinicaltrial.gov, and as you see here in the U.S., there's about 100,000 trials going on. But in China, it's about only 10% of what's going on in the U.S. So in terms of population, China really have a very long way to go, but I think there's also a great potential and opportunity there. So what's the pros and cons of doing clinical trials in China? And one is a very large patient population, especially naive patient population there. And I'm not going to elaborate that too much, but also cost can be a good factor. But if you look at the hospital staff, the several hospitals we've been working with very closely, we find the trainings, actually, we need much more extensive training of the hospital staff, including the nurse, so that they can comply with the GCP requirements. So that takes definitely much more efforts. And also hospital commitment and control, that's another thing. Sometimes contracts work, sometimes you have to negotiate outside of the contract. So that's just a way of working. And also in terms of data management and central lab supports, I think there's room for improvement for clinical trials done in China to move to a higher standard. Now, another critical component is the GLP, which is the preclinical animal testing. And this is a very important part for new drug development. And it has a little bit longer history than GCP, but still not very long, 35 years. And first started in 1980s. And again, all the IND enabling studies submit to SFDA need to be done in SFDA certified GLP laboratories. And there are subtle differences, but the difference is not as big as that in GCP. So if you're interested, I'll be available to talk to you more, but I will just summarize them here. So finally, the last two slides, opportunities. China and U.S., I think as a lot of our previous speakers talk already, these two countries face a lot of common health threats, including not only infectious disease, but also other potential health threats such as nuclear accidents and radiation injuries. And the money also, no matter, even U.S. is the number one investor in healthcare, and China now is rapidly catching up, but still the money is never enough, especially now it's getting so expensive to get a new product out. So there is a lot of potentials for the two countries to share resources. Resource needs not only funding, but also talented scientists, even skilled technicians and specialized capabilities, and also new innovation products. And with our personal experience in the last almost 9 years, we see really a huge potential for the two countries from the government side and also from the private sector. There are a lot of potentials for working together to get a new biomedical products so that the whole process is better, faster, more cost effective. And especially, I think that's one of our dreams is to benefit a larger population. Thank you.
I think you guys both raised a number of interesting points that we can discuss a little bit. And if anybody in the audience has questions, please feel free to step up to the microphones. But maybe I can start with you, Frank, first. You talked a bit about how the goals of your research is to take some of your research products and transfer them over to industry. Could you say a little bit more about how that works at the Chinese Academy of Sciences, and if you have a product that comes out of your laboratory, how do you get that into an industry partner and through the regulatory processes?
Thank you. At the beginning I mentioned about the Chinese Academy. Used to be the research institutions only focus on the fundamental research. And the recent years, and because the money from the central government, so based on the Chinese economic developing so rapidly, I think that we have a shortage of research support. So from that point, the Chinese Academy now is really promote technology transfers, and to try to let you work with industry, and then you have to make sure you have intelligent property protect very well, and then you can do the technique transfer. Just this the basically Also another thing is they can encourage you build small business, so you can have some shares in the companies, and then so you can also recruit some money from the capital money from the NGO fund, and also because government has some small fund money for the really technology transfers. So the same to be just like a state. Scientists have more freedom to play around to have potential products come out.
And so in light of the recent global recession and the limited availability of funds, are you seeing that the environment for developing medicines and vaccines in China is still strong, or is there still interest from the private industry side to invest in these products and develop them?
I think that in China, they have stayed around some business, the companies also. It's certainly a major. Is a major players, the private sectors still is not a dominant. But to give example is Sinopec. I'm mentioning here is the private sectors. Used to be there's nothing, but recent years, I think that they got a lot of money from the government to support some products developed. So now it's doing well. But however, so we have a potential market and still need the more quality products, in China. So and also another from regulation, point, you can see if you have some products from U.S. and go to the Chinese market, that way pretty easy because everything we learn, basically try to learn from FDA, you know, what the regulatory they have, we try to have similar standard, and then we can evaluate the products.
Ong, did you have any other added comments to that?
Yeah, well, I think the Chinese pharmaceutical market is very interesting and very different. I probably won't have time to explain why. I'll just give you one example, because I had dinner about 2 weeks ago with the fastest growing Chinese pharmaceutical company in China. So they have a single product that has a sale of 3.3 billion RMB. Okay, that's the biggest sale of a single agent. But you know what kind of product that is? That's a Chinese herbal medicine. And they don't have clear even clinical endpoint in trials. So they don't know exactly what is the mechanism of action, but they have great sales force. So you know it's a fast growing industry, and that's also going through fundamental changes. As I said earlier, for example, that HIV drug I showed you, so now it's close to NDA phase, and there's a lot of discussion actually how to price it. You know, who is going to buy that, and who set the price? So there's a lot of changes going on.
Dan.
Dr. G, you mentioned the importance of regulatory pathways, and certainly in the U.S., just domestically, the challenges of the regulatory pathway, well known, and particularly for medical countermeasures, for threat agents that aren't everyday requirements for treatment, even more challenging. Are there developments internationally, as you managing a company that's at least trying to balance two regulatory pathways, to bridge more global regulatory pathways that seem promising to you?
Yeah, I think that's a million-dollar question there. To be frank with you, we don't have an answer, okay? It's in work in progress, or we are trying to do that. But there are subtle differences, for example, even in the preclinical requirements between U.S. and China. That's if you look at the guidance, there are some conflicts in there. So we've been trying to have a dialogue with SFDA now, but we will probably do that soon with US FDA, because there are no fundamental difference. It's really just a different way of practice.
Great, thanks. This is a great, excellent presentation. I wanted to touch on the issue of vaccine and medication safety. I think that there is a lot of, you know, if you're in China, there's a lot of concern among the Chinese themselves about the safety of vaccines and pharmaceuticals, particularly during influenza. I think there was a great demand for imported vaccines. And of course, there was a lot of uptake of domestic production, but there was sort of mistrust of them. Some of that is obviously misplaced. It's based on, you know, other contamination events in food and in the environment, but some of it may be real. And so the question is, what initiatives are underway in China to improve? I mean, vaccine safety is a huge issue in the United States, and vaccine safety and pharmaceutical safety, and there's a lot more interest in setting up large-scale observational studies to look at post-licensure how safety occurs after licensure and marketing. So I'm wondering what is going on in China to address that issue as well. And also, if you could touch on one of the curious things I found about China was that vaccines had been licensed before there was a central SFDA, and some vaccines were licensed actually at the provincial level, and whether those vaccines are ever going to go back through regulatory approval.
Answer? I just, some agree, some don't agree. You probably have some, you know, information maybe not very balanced, and. As I know from that point, China now is really push very hard for the quality of the vaccine, and very, very hard. You know, also we have some good vaccine. You know, in the last 10 years doing very well. You know, HPV vaccine is doing very well, and there's no any. Side effect so far I know, and also the rabies vaccine is doing so well, and certainly there are some small, some other companies that are not really practice, you know, very well. They try to, because, for example, two years ago, one the company from the Liaoning province, they're a small company, they're doing the rabies vaccines, but the vaccination effect is not great. I mean, that cannot produce very good antibody titers. So what they did? They put some poly IC stuff and try to boost vaccine, you know. And certainly this measurement is illegal. And then the government just really shut down the companies, you know, really shut down the manufacturers. So China now really not only focus on the drug, you know, management, drug, you know, the food, but the other issues, you know. So we are really push hard. And we also, you know, as a scientist, we also proposal to the central government. So we needed to have a strong law enforcement to clean up all the, you know, dirty, you know, the conduct. So.
Yeah, I would just add on what Frank said. Product safety. When problem arises, there could be different causes for that, right? One is contamination and quality control. That's probably what a lot of people talk about. So China SFDA actually issued, reinforced GMP requirements for, you know, every pharmaceutical products. So the requirement is much more stringent, and hopefully, you know, that will increase the quality and also improve the safety. There could be other issues. Another observation, actually, through our talks with the different government agencies, especially interaction with SFDA, is very interesting. Chinese regulatory agencies tend to take responsibilities of these safety issues when they occur. But actually, you know, what we think that the responsibility should be the manufacturer. So there is a lot of discussion now shifting the responsibility, you know, who takes what. And that's also one difference we see between the SFDA and FDA approach on that.
You know, we are still learning. You know, I remember I back China in 2004. At that time, you know, we have very good facility, but we don't know how to, you know, have a good management. You know, the concept is changing. You know, the value will be changed. You know, I think we learn a lot of things from here. You know, I got my education from here. We learn a lot of things, not only you training your students, but also you do your practice. You know, so it's a value. So I think we now is getting there and learn more and do more practice. So, you know.
Well, I think that's another good positive note to end on. So thank you, Frank, and thank you, Dong. And please join me in thanking our panelists.